time. Started turning into two times, a few times. They've been sober in a long time. Yeah, used to be all mine, all mine. It feels like last night you came over.
Mike, did you ask, what did you write to Santa for Christmas? Did you send him your list yet? Because the deadline's coming.
I asked him for, let's see, peace in the Middle East, but mostly for Israel. I asked him for, let's see, no more gun violence, but only in the blue states, because that's the one I live. So, like, red states seem to like it.
Well, there's no Democratic or left population in the red states.
No.
So
that's why it's okay to talk trash about all those states that I don't live in.
Yeah, and that's why I like living in Texas.
As a Republican.
Yes, as a Republican myself, I enjoy the gun violence in my state.
Well, I was asked by someone who knows that I do this with you and that you're not from here. I was asked, is your friend like happy about the Rittenhouse results?
He's from Texas, right? So he's probably
a racist.
he's probably racist and probably pro gun, right? And he probably likes that he shot those people and got away with it, right?
He's homophobic too.
That's how that works. Well, I'll have you know, absolutely.
I do think it's a good thing. And I'm so glad he...
And Mike...
Imagine you do that, and the first thing you do is do a fucking interview with Tucker Carlson and then fly to Florida to meet Trump. Fuck it. I'll say it on Mike. If I ever saw that kid, it's going down. Hands are being thrown.
Yeah.
Fuck what? Him. Ugly-ass kid.
I fully expect him to get very hurt soon.
Hope so.
Or wind up dead.
You know what? I'll take it a step further. Same to his parents.
You know what? Fair enough.
And welcome to Cinema of the State, the first ever Blink-182 film discussion and anti-Rittenhouse discussion podcast.
I was gonna say, I mean, this started talking about what we wanted for Christmas. And your asks for I'm Troy Sinberg, by the way, and that's Michael McKay. Your requests from Santa for Christmas were very selfless.
I'm just that type of guy. I'm much like his son.
Yeah, you wanted peace in the Middle East, especially for Israel.
They need it. But what about you, Mr. Trace?
Probably some socks.
Ah, socks are nice.
Yeah, maybe.
I collect on mental hospital socks.
Oh, the grippy socks?
Ain't no way I'm slipping.
You never catch me slipping, because I got the grippy socks.
Yeah.
Maybe just a nice frozen pizza from the grocery store that I can have for dinner that night.
Imagine you go to the mental hospital and they say, look, we ran out of grippy socks. We had to go to Sky Zone. First of all, we had to play at Sky Zone. That's why it took an hour. We had a lot of fun. But we got you them socks.
We got you the grippy socks.
That because I know you guys are going to try to like jump off the roof.
Sometimes
like crazy. I wouldn't know anything about that though.
Sometimes. Sometimes when Annie's feeling not feeling great, she'll feeling overwhelmed, she's like, I'm really about to be going on a grippy socks vacation. Like, if this doesn't
You know what? That's like, okay. That type of behavior is the type of person who maybe drinks too much at night and then they wake up the next morning and you know what they're feeling? Hungover.
Oh, like the song
Hungover You from Blink-182's 8th album, 9.
Yeah, the 8th album.
Track 14.
Yeah, how do we both listen to it, correct?
Yeah, I will say probably one of the more forgettable ones, I think, because I had to skim through it before we started recording.
Yes, you did, and I got a little bit of a reminder of it myself, because I agree that it's a pretty, I don't think it's bad, but it's definitely is forgettable. It kind of just blends in with the rest of the album. Except for, I think the chorus stands out in maybe a bad way. The way that it's like so explosive with the guitars and the vocals almost sounds like blown out. Like it almost sounds like it's not, like it wasn't mixed properly. I don't know.
Yeah, we definitely enjoy it not as much as we did as last week's, because we recorded last week's episode, remember? We're
right,
not putting this
out
of order. Last week's song was great.
Yeah, it was.
I love that song. One of my favorite songs ever.
Hungover You cannot hold a candle to last week's song. Like, after hearing that, I don't know. Like, I don't know why they even continued making this album after that. That should have been it.
On Hungover You.
Because, of course, they made this chronologically. And they're,
so they're, same way we record them.
Yeah.
Schedules? Fuck that. On Hungover You, Blink-182 sings about exactly what the title says. Being hungover someone and getting drunk because of it. The song sees the...
Being hungover someone?
Like, you're not over...
I've never heard that.
I don't know.
I guess I've just never heard that, like, turn of phrase before about, like...
A chick.
Being... about being hung up on someone, like being hung over someone.
The song sees the band experimenting with the program beats and an explosive chorus where Mark Hoppus and Matt Skiba join forces in the vocal department. Yeah, that's not something they've never done before.
Yeah, they're finally joining forces.
Again, I think I'm gonna say the weakest thing of this album is like the hip hop drums.
I agree.
I don't like it. I love Travis Barker to death. Congrats on your engagement to a Kardashian.
Well, his credits on this song are extensive. Piano, Travis Barker. Programmer, Travis Barker. Drums, Travis Barker. Percussion, Travis Barker.
Man won't stop.
He will not stop. Written by, not Travis. Oh, Travis
you
Barker.
Got it written there by just go. For hitting this the skins, man.
This has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 songwriting credits to write this thing.
It took that many people. They're all getting drunk and they're just like dropping. I picked that word. They're like, oh, we have to credit him.
Shit, don't suggest anything else. We're not crediting anybody else on this song.
Hush up. No more. So Mark Hoppus in the first verse, he says, a bottle for breakfast trying to let go. Remember your voice, but it's only an echo. Only an echo. I still got your makeup here on my pillow, and I'm seeing ghosts outside of my window. Alrighty, okay. So, bottle for breakfast trying to let go. That's drinking. Bad. You should never... Unless it's a mimosa.
To me, it sounded like he was eating the bottle.
Oh, like that. Crunching on glass.
Actually, I can annotate this song.
We're back, bitches!
I don't know what it is about this song that I don't have to be a super smart genius annotator to annotate it, but I am gonna ask the question, does this mean he is
eating a glass
eating
bottle?
A glass bottle. Ouch. That's gotta hurt. There we go.
I still got your makeup here on my pillow. Little baby girl, you gotta take off your makeup or else you're gonna get acne.
Also, you're just ruining my
white
sheets and pillows. And
do you realize where I was going with these later tonight?
Some of this doesn't come out. Now I have to buy a whole new bed set
for the whole thing.
You don't get in a bed with makeup.
Why were you wearing bronzer all over your body?
There's just an outline of you in my white sheets.
And I'm seeing ghosts outside of my window. That's creepy.
That's like that scene
from SpongeBob, the haunted
SpongeBob
shopping list.
Oh yes, exactly like that.
But what were you gonna say? What was your reference?
There's a scene in Insidious with a ghost outside of a window.
Yeah, but I haven't seen those, so why would you reference that? So
you haven't seen Insidious?
No.
You haven't?
No.
We should watch that together.
Okay. Sure.
Okay, sure. All
right. Add it to the list.
Okay.
I've seen The Conjuring 2.
Others. I feel like that... I feel like Insidious was, like, kind of a mini-cultural phenomenon, so, like, it's weird that you haven't seen it.
I wasn't watching horror movies in 2011.
Too scared?
I was way too scared. PBG... Especially, I wasn't watching, like... I wasn't gonna, like, give a PG-13 one the chance.
That, to this day, Annie cites as the scariest movie she's ever seen. Like, that movie... Like, she'll think about that movie, and then... She gets freaked out and she can't.
But like, I can't even think of like there's just like Halloween is like one of my favorites, but I don't think it's scary. Like nothing is like nothing creep like nothing like will fuck with my head for the rest of my life, I feel like, movie wise. Yeah,
nowadays it's hard for a horror movie to actually like stick with me, like past seeing it. Like there are some horror movies that I'll get tensed up during.
But I'm trying to think of like things that I saw like as a kid that have like negatively affected me, and I really can't think of any like movies. Trust me, things have negatively affected me as a child, but none of them. Nothing from the cinema.
The one I may have talked about this before on the show, but the big one for me was Steven Spielberg's War of the Worlds. Really did a small number on me after seeing it.
Because you heard it on the radio.
Yeah.
You're like, Orson Welles is trying to kill us.
Trace, why do you know who Orson Welles is?
I will always think it's the funniest thing that people thought Orson Welles started an alien invasion, deadass. What's that pre-chorus? And fuck it, chorus too, Trace.
Alright, so the pre-chorus, as in... the verse before the chorus. It was just one time. Started turning into two times, a few times. Ain't been sober in a long time. Yeah, you used to be all mine. And then that leads right into this chorus, where Matt and Mark join forces, according to the genius annotator.
Like Goku and Vegeta.
Just like that. It feels like last night you came over. Now I wake up and you're nowhere. I've got my head hung over you. I guess I'm still hung over you.
So it was one time, started as two times, a few times. Let's try to be real geniuses and annotate that and write, is he talking about drinking or having sexual intercourse with a female?
Is he talking about drinking or having... sexual intercourse with a female.
Comma, the opposite gender.
Okay, just in case anyone's confused, we don't want anybody...
Someone's gonna yell, there's more
to,
than...
To misconstrue anything we're talking about.
There's more than two genders.
Yeah. But we, like for this purposes, no, there's not. We just need to.
I'll be honest, Trace. I was signing up for something where it just gave me like all of the pronoun options, and I was like, I haven't heard of any of these.
You don't identify as Z?
What the fuck is that? It feels like last night you came over. Now I wake up and you're nowhere. Then she didn't.
Wow. It's like when you have a one-night stand and the girl leaves.
Aw, man. Come on.
Because she's more mature than you.
She doesn't want to sleep next to you, you ugly piece of crap.
All right, that was a little mean. They're not pieces of...
I don't think I would leave Mark Coppas or Matt Skiba if I had sex with them the night before.
No, if I had sex with Mark Coppas or Matt Skiba or Travis Barker, I would stay... And we would have a lovely breakfast together and maybe, like, spend the day...
A bottle for breakfast.
Yeah, a bottle for breakfast. And then we would spend the day, like, maybe go to a museum, go to the park. We could go get some brunch. Maybe see, like, go to the cinema. We would have a lovely day together after we had sex the night before.
Me taking the Blink-182 boys to the Museum of Tolerance.
Yeah, where they need to go.
Have you heard some of the things they're saying in these songs? Oy.
They're extremely intolerant. And you know what? I'm tolerant of everything except intolerance.
Dude, same. Let's erase racism.
You know what? Turn that pencil around, put that little pink into the page, and watch as it magically disappears. But It doesn't fully go away. You're still going to have some marks from the pencil that are that's kind of left over.
I used to say racism. You have to watch out for those. No, get a new piece of paper.
You fucked this one up.
So Mark says in verse 2, I was so wasted I couldn't see you. Didn't seem like a choice. No, I'd never leave you. Parentheses, never leave you. Just like what we said. Nights that we stayed up, days that we sleep through. I can still see your face outside of my window.
She breathed on it.
She was breathing on the window. And then she wrote, like, she put her face up against it to leave, like little nose marks.
Really gross stuff.
But he was so wasted he couldn't see her. Like, so first of all, he doesn't even know if she's here. That's why you don't remember, Mark, because you're so damn wasted.
Well, this is from all those bottles he's having for breakfast. That have those traces of alcohol on them.
Yeah, because you're not getting a lot of the alcohol. It's just making a big. Once you take that first bite in the glass, like you're just getting the alcohol on your clothes, but you're a little residue of like some nice alcohol, some nice tasty alcohol.
Yeah, it's making its way through your system.
Oh, absolutely.
Absolutely. I mean, what else happens in this song? I don't know. Like,
there's a bridge you have to reach, Chris. We have one more thing.
Oh.
Oh, no, I don't even want to read that, because it just says I'll read the bridge.
The people need to know.
Trace loves you guys. Be that lucky.
A bottle for breakfast, trying to let go. Remember your voice, but it's only an echo. There we go.
Oh, so glad I heard that.
Do you remember that children's movie, Earth to Echo?
Is that the one with like a little robot?
Yeah, it's like a little guy in it.
I do remember Earth to Echo. Did I see it? No, because even that, I was like, that's probably bad. That looks like it's
for kids. I saw that movie for some reason. I don't remember why.
The one movie I have in my head as a kid that I remember making my dad take me to is a movie called Good Boy, where Matthew Broderick voices a dog from space.
Oh, okay. I think I've seen the poster.
He's a good boy.
Let me see. Hold on. Well, good boy, Matthew.
Well, he's not a good boy.
Broderick.
And I've already figured out my transition.
Let me look at this poster real quick. 2003, comedy and sci-fi, an hour 27 minutes. And it's got a young boy laying on his stomach in a doghouse with his head sticking. Well, this is the DVD cover, I guess. With his head sticking out, it's got Rover is about to take over.
Uh-oh. Watch out for Rover. Hmm. He's about to take over.
Special edition DVD. Okay.
Matthew Broderick, who once got in a bad car accident and killed two people. Wow. That much like Stephen King's 1986 killer car movie Maximum Overdrive?
Whoa!
What is going on?
I don't know!
The time has come for maximum terror. The time has come for Maximum King.
You're going to get us in an awful lot of trouble, man.
We already in trouble.
Dino De Laurentiis presents Stephen King's Maximum Overdrive, rated R.
Starts Friday, July 25th at theaters everywhere.
This guy, Stephen King, loves to have cars be killing people. two stories about.
That seems to be a preoccupation of his, is machines, especially cars, being brought to life and killing people.
However, not as lucky as Christine to have its film adaption made by John Carpenter.
Yeah, instead, this one was made by the man himself.
Straight from the horse's mouth.
Straight from the king's crown. Is Maximum Overdrive. It came out in 1986. It's listed as a comedy horror, so I guess it's...
I think it's a comedy. I'd say it's like a dark comedy where it's like self-aware of what it's doing. Like it's over the top.
It's so ridiculous that, it definitely has to know that it's what is happening. Like, I saw some people on Letterboxd being like, it's not scary in the slightest. I'm like, what do you expect? I don't think it's supposed to be. It's not really, like, what it's doing.
But that is a change of pace from the usual Stephen King tone, because I feel like he's never really making, like, full-on comedies like
this.
Yeah,
this is pretty different from, like, this is the only movie he's ever directed, and it's very different in tone from it, really any of his books, as far as I know. I'm not read up
this
on
this.
This
is also
Stephen
the
King,
third Stephen King movie we've done.
What have we done so far?
Creepshow
and Misery.
Misery. And now this one. All Misery is the only one based on a book. Creepshow is written by Stephen King and George Romero. And this is written and directed by George Romero. And I mean, this is written and directed by Stephen King.
Well,
and I don't know if you saw in the IMDb trivia, but apparently, according to that, George Romero might have ghost directed this.
I did read that. And after reading that and, like, kind of thinking back on some of the movie, I was like, actually, that makes a lot of sense. If that's true. Because I could see it.
Because according to Stephen King, who doesn't straight up deny that, what he says is, I did ask him for advice and he was on set a few times. So who knows? But
what I read is that he was on set a bunch and that Stephen King was always referring to him for advice.
Hey,
so,
George...
like, hey, how do I set up the... How do I turn the camera on?
But those of you who don't know Stephen King's work ethic back in the day.
He was a very proficient worker.
Due to?
His willingness to get the job done.
And cocaine.
No!
The main ingredient of Stephen King's books are co-written by cocaine.
Yeah, it is a known
Have you read
secret
it?
That... I've not read it, but I'm aware of the things
that it's like
in the book. It
1,300 pages.
That's mostly why I haven't read it.
It's no, it's a Bible.
It's a million pages long. Yeah,
everyone knows 1,300 is a million pages long.
It is. There's a child orgy and a space turtle.
And like, why is that not the one thing you bring into the film? The space turtle. Like, we need space.
The space. Yeah. Why is that left? Why is that on the cutting room floor?
Come on.
What happened?
I was really pulling for space turtle in the second one.
Yeah, I was pissed.
I threw my fucking phone on the floor and said, "I'm out of here."
I threw it at the screen and ripped a hole through the fucking wall. And I said, peace, bitches, and flipped the bird to everybody and walked out.
Remember when they delayed Gangster Squad because of the scene in the trailer where they shoot through the movie theater screen and then they were like, that's a little bit like Batman.
Oh my god, I forgot that happened. Yeah.
That was the first time cancel culture happened.
It's been a slippery slope since then.
So, this movie got negative reviews, earned golden raspberries for worst director and worst actor. It was nominated, didn't win.
It lost for those worst awards.
And King disowned the film, describing it as a moron movie and considered the process a learning experience, after which he intended to never direct again. Although there was other times where he said, maybe I'll consider directing again if I'm sober. Ha ha ha.
Would that make you feel better or shittier that you lost the worst film awards?
Better. You don't want to win.
I would almost be like, at least let me win the worst film award so I can get something. Like, I'm already nominated for it. At least let me be the worst. You know what I mean? I don't know.
So, Trace, does the name Dino De Laurentiis mean anything to you?
Not really.
So, Dino De Laurentiis was a prolific film producer in the 1970s and 80s.
He's an Italian.
He's an Italian man. He produced Blue Velvet. He produced Dune, the original. He produced Halloween 2, it says. That's crazy. I'm trying to say. And then he also made the King Kong remake from forever ago. He directed that. I mean, he produced the King Kong remake from 1970s. He made a lot of, like, but he's also very cheap with his work, I feel like.
Right.
So.
Very, very prolific catalog here.
Extreme. So it says that Stephen King originally wanted Bruce Springsteen to play the Emilio Estevez part, but Springsteen was unknown by De Laurentiis, so Dino personally hired, in quotes, Martin Sheen's son, Emilio Estevez. It is believed that Dino's insistence that Estevez participate in the film was when Stephen King became disillusioned with the production. King did not try to create a positive environment for the crew, and at one point renting out an entire theater to screen classic films such as Godzilla and Night of the Living Dead. He provided free refreshments and personal commentary during each film. Oh, great. I want to watch King.
Yeah, Kong.
Do his fucking riff tracks on Godzilla.
My fucking boss is over here talking through the damn movie he bought for us to watch.
Stephen King put himself in this movie.
He did. He has a scene where he gets called.
First line.
He does. Yeah.
He has the very first roll of dialogue in this film, which is about an alien comet, which looks like a green cloud. Thing. And that thing takes over Earth, pretty much.
Pretty much, yeah.
Takes over our technology, the thing we value the most.
Yeah, the thing that we have come to rely on to a fault, I would say, in the modern age, is now out to attack us in Stephen King's Maximum Overdrive. But especially...
our cars.
Trucks. And our cars. Yes, that.
And our ATMs.
Which is kind of fun, like... Yeah, there's a few examples of all the machines taking over, like the ATM, the soda machine, the knife thing.
Oh, the soda machine part's so cool.
The soda machine part is pretty funny. But it chooses to focus on mainly 18-wheelers. It's like the big thing that we need to watch out for.
Well, because they're big.
I guess it's just because they're big, I guess.
Well, like, the opening... Well, another piece of technology that attacks us is bridges. And I'm not talking about bridges. Jeff.
No, he would never. It is a physical bridge that you have to cross.
But what do they call them? Drawbridges? The ones that open?
Yeah, like a draw. Yeah, like a drawbridge.
Yeah, it opens, and then all the cars start sliding down. They didn't put the e-brake on.
Whoa!
Ah, we're all falling. Oh no. Oh god. That's the first
my watermelons.
That's the first time technology causes death, I feel like.
Yes.
And then exposition in the opening scene, it like says the comet was around for 8 days. Like it lets us
Yeah.
Like something that probably could have been put at the end of the movie, I don't know.
And then it kind of is, like it says that it leaves. Like, oh okay, bye.
So the trucks are, the cars are falling after the bridge, and then there's a bunch of kids who are about to play Little League, and their coach is going to buy them sodas, but nothing's coming out of the machine. He's like,
yet.
And then he just gets hit within the gut. He gets hit right in the head, leaves a
right in the
beautiful mark on his face. And then the best part is when, like, these kids, like, the soda machine is, like, almost throwing and aiming at literal children. Like, it's not just like, shooting out straight for it. It's like the kids are running in different directions and it's going at them.
Yeah, it is like specifically able to aim the sodas right at where the kids are somehow.
And then Emilio Estevez is working at a diner / truck stop.
Can I just say the plot to this movie is like almost... like it is completely
written and directed by someone on cocaine.
Yeah, like it is so just like clearly just a non-entity, and this movie is mostly an excuse just to like watch trucks run over people or explode or see people get killed by various other methods by machines, like
steamroller.
The actual story here is just like nothing is happening here.
There's a girl, she gets into a car with a guy, it's an old dude who's a creep, and she's like, stop, you creep. And then she gets the radio to play, like, the news, and the news is like, yeah, cars are attacking people, you probably don't want to be in one of them.
Yeah, and then he's like, hey, don't ignore that, baby.
Yeah, and then she, like, takes the wheel and steers it into, like, the truck stop, and then that's where they're hanging out for the rest of the movie as they, like, pretty much play shelter away from the trucks trying to kill them.
Yeah. Pretty much. And the head truck, the main villain truck, is the Green Goblin.
Norman Osborn himself leads our crew of trucks. To which, no involvement from Marvel. Could not find... This was an unlicensed thing, I believe.
Weird.
There's also the little boy. Like, there's, like, kind of subplots. There's, like, two or three subplots going on while the trucks are, like, kind of attacking people. There's a newly married couple.
Yeah.
Played by Lisa Simpson.
Oh, is that?
That's Lisa Simpson.
Okay.
That's why I don't know if you heard me before, Trace. I referred to her as a girl who likes to play the saxophone.
Oh, I don't know if I heard that actually. Okay.
The other person who's in this movie is one Giancarlo Esposito.
That's true.
Gus Fring himself, baby. In this Indeed. Bad boy. Gets killed by an arcade machine.
The worst way to go.
The last thing I want to happen is have Pac-Man kill me.
Hey, I always hear that. Hey, those video games and those sodas, they'll
kill you.
They're going to be the death of you. I never thought it was like this.
I thought trucks were killing us because of pollution, not literally.
Hey, I didn't know I was going to be getting run over by one.
Eventually, a new vehicle comes in. And this is a little golf cart thingy with a gun attached to it.
Yeah.
And boy, is he terrifying. He will shoot anyone. He doesn't give a shit. And then the little boy who was on the baseball team that escaped shows up. This is going to be the shortest episode, but that's okay.
Yeah, it's fine.
It's okay. The things we do for you. Little boy is like, wait a minute. Is this car trying to talk to us? Also, I just remembered there's a part where a tow truck attacks, and I was like, tow-mater. The little boy is like, hey, that thing is beeping at us in Morse code. And they're like, are you sure? And he's like, yeah, I've got my Eagle Scouts badge. I'm a professional.
Yes.
And then the thing's like, listen, if you don't feed us soon, we're going to fucking kill you all.
Yeah,
they want fuel. Like,
they want fuel and then... What?
It's like it's no real ending. It's like it literally they give them like, enough fuel until they escape. And
that's why like I almost don't even know how to like talk about what happens. It's like they manage to escape and then title like text.
Well, the
comes
way
on
they escape is like funny enough, I think, that they like hide and they blow all the trucks up secretly. And then they go on a boat. They said that what was the part? What did they say about it? That there's an island with no technology they need to escape to.
Oh yeah, something like that.
A haven.
And then yeah.
Dumb.
There are some cool truck explosions.
Definitely.
I
love when
things
blow up.
I liked watching trucks massacre people and then blow up.
One thing that's funny about this movie is that it says that the trucks. I mean, it says that the truck stop was created for the movie and that people were eventually stopping by and, like, trying to get gas. And they're like, oh, we don't have that. This is a set, buddy. And then
also,
they put an ad out in the paper that said, stop coming here.
We would be remiss to ignore the fact that AC/DC did... all of the music for the film.
Sort of.
Yeah.
Did you look into that a little bit?
Not really. I just know that it says music by AC/DC and that they were selected by Stephen King himself.
Stephen King is a huge fan of AC/DC, and when he got to meet them, he asked them if they would provide music for the film. He also offered the band a role in the film, but AC/DC declined, saying that they are not actors. Claims that there is a scene with the band on a boat are untrue. However, the band agreed to do the soundtrack after Stephen King sung Ain't No Fun from their 1976 album Dirty Deeds Done Dirt Cheap. King sang the entire song from start to finish, and the band laughingly agreed that if he was such a fan, they would do it for him. AC/DC would perform all but two songs featured in the movie, which I don't know if you noticed. There is a score kind of like that's like... that's like very like obviously
yeah.
Not them. Because it's not really a score that they do. It's kind of all a soundtrack.
Mm-hmm.
It says AC/DC performed all but two songs featured in the film, including two unreleased mixes of previously recorded songs, and the entire 1987 album Who Made Who is the soundtrack to this movie. The rest of the songs are from previous AC/DC albums. At the time of release, many music stores had no idea the album Who Made Who was a compilation soundtrack for this movie, and many mislabeled the album as an AC/DC greatest hits. Limited pressings of the album did feature the movie's logo, stating it was the soundtrack to Stephen King's Maximum Overdrive, but this was later removed from future pressings.
Whoa. Interesting.
Another interesting thing is that the trailer for this movie used John Carpenter's score for Halloween 3.
Really?
Apparently. Which is another... Dino De Laurentiis produced Halloween 2 and 3.
Okay. So just reusing assets from other projects.
Yeardley Smith, the voice of Lisa Simpson, is greatly embarrassed by this film. To which I say, why? What do you have?
Don't be. Like,
you have one show that's been on too long that to your name. Why are you shitting on this?
I know. Like, I get how this movie's maybe quote-unquote bad. But...
fun watching this, like, this is, like, I kind of wish he made more movies. I think he has an interesting film.
It's, it's weird, and, like, it's, like, whacked out enough, and, like, just nuts enough that it's fun to watch. Like, I don't know, I don't know what else you want going into this movie about killer 18-wheelers coming to life and running over people. Like, if this isn't the movie that you wanted from that, then this movie was never going to be a success to you. I don't know.
Here's my theory is that, so Stephen King books take place in Maine, but if Stephen King is the director, it's North Carolina only. However, he's made a lot more books than movies.
Interesting. Interesting. That's an interesting theory. We'll have to wait for his next directorial feature.
Why hasn't he made more?
He said he was done after this one. He said this was a bad enough experience that he never wanted to do it again.
Well, here's the thing. In October 2020, Stephen King's son, Joe Hill, too embarrassed by the last name King, buddy, expressed interest to write and direct the Maximum Overdrive remake with some alterations to the original material. Yeah, we're going to put newer cars. He is the son of authors Tabitha and Stephen King and the brother of writer Owen King. Have you ever heard of this guy?
Joe Hill?
Yeah.
Yeah, because he, that Black Phone movie that Scott Derrickson made is based off of his short stories.
Let's see, he's written on some TV shows, hasn't really directed on, so yeah, why not make his directorial debut his father's directorial debut?
Yeah, fuck it, just, just do what, the Dune author's son did, and start
just writing more books.
Yeah, extrapolating off of your father's work. That's fine.
That's how you make it in this business. He also wrote the book Nose for Atu, which is an FX show a couple years ago, I think.
Nose for Atu.
I would be caught dead rather than reading something called NOS number 4 A2. Would eat a brick before I read something called that.
That's not even a real word.
He should be ashamed. He's like, I'm trying to become my own thing. I'm trying to, like, not ride off the coattails of my father, Stephen King. First book, Nosferatu. Then again, if my dad was famous, I would write, like, whatever. I would just, like, steal
it. Jason Reitman, who has finally taken over his legacy.
Finally, we made Ghostbusters into Star Wars.
Yay! Have you seen, like, interviews with him talking about Ghostbusters Afterlife where he's like,
I was ashamed to do this for a while, but now I'm ready. That.
Well, like, the way he words it, though, he's like, I was running away from my legacy for so long. And I decided it was finally time for me to embrace it.
But also, do you know how many people have fathers who are, like, directors that haven't just remade what they did?
Yeah, like,
like, no, this isn't, like, a thing you have to do, bro.
No one gives a shit, dumbass. Also, the production of Maximum Overdrive led to the permanent injury of one of the crew members.
Trace, so glad you brought that up, because I completely forgot. That's one of the most important things about this movie's legacy, is that we have a cinematographer who, like Dino De Laurentiis, is Italian, Armando Nannucci. This is a man, and there's some guy on the crew who, like, was who Dino thought spoke Italian enough that he could be the communicator, and apparently that didn't go well. Apparently the Italian guy just goes, yes, 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 to every question he was asked.
Well, he said yes.
So then, it's involving the lawnmower.
They were shooting the scene with when a lawnmower comes alive. And
it would suck if it wasn't the lawnmower scene when that happened.
Yeah. The cinematographer was hit in his quote shooting eye, his right eye.
Oh no, the eye I use for filmmaking.
Oh no. My working eye.
Well, now
it's by a splinter of wood that had become lodged in the blade. And so the camera assistant, Sylvia Giuletti, said that we were shooting a scene where...
Italian.
Mamma mia, you got shot in the eye.
Oh, you're drinking this!
We were shooting a scene where a lawnmower, the machine that cut the grass...
Luca!
Was following a boy to kill him. And we put the camera on the ground with piece of wood beneath to wedge, okay?
Have you seen Luca, Trace?
I haven't seen
There's no before. Italian actors in Luca.
That is so fucked up.
Right?
Anyway... I remember that Armando Nannuzzi asked to Stephen King, can we take out the blades? But Stephen King say, no, no, I like to see them. Armando say, but we don't see them in the shot. But Stephen King say, no, no, better that you let it. And so the special effects department had also suggested removing the blade for safety reasons, but King continued to insist that it remain so that the scene could appear more lifelike. Even though you apparently could not see the blades. And so...
Boy, did Bruce Springsteen dodge a bullet.
So...
the boss really missed one.
Yeah. Nannuzzi was helicoptered from set and then flown into a hospital in Raleigh, where he eventually lost his eye. They halted production, but then he came back to finish the movie. And then after the movie was released, he sued King De Laurentiis Productions and 16 others involved with the film for $18 million. The suit was filed in New York, as King and many of the other defendants often did business in that state, and then the case was settled later on. And then Nannuzzi continued to work on films after his accident, but believed he would never again be considered for large-budget projects, as producers wouldn't want a cameraman with no depth perception.
Aww.
But he went back to Italy and worked until he retired.
He only did two more movies, according to this.
Well, probably because of his fucking eye.
Well, also, it looks like all of his movies were Italian movies, which, like, it's my big break.
Oh, no.
My
Stephen King. Stephen King ruined my life.
He make me miserable. He wrote a misery, and now I'm a miserable. Guys, this movie is like a 100 on the dot.
Yeah, I'll give it I'll do 90 out of 182.
Well, as previously, as we opened this episode, it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
Christmas? Next week.
Let's just say next week is not another Christmas song.
What?
Literally! That's the name. Oh! That's the name of this. It's called Not Another Christmas Song by Blink-182. We thought...
I bet the listeners thought...
did not come out until a few years ago. So had we done this podcast a few years ago, we would have probably not done a second Christmas episode.
I bet that our listeners thought that you meant we were not doing a Christmas song.
No, no, no.
But instead, the name of the song is Not Another Christmas. That is genius, Mike.
And the film that we will be watching, not discussing, we'll be watching, commentary, baby. Everyone's favorite type of episode. Or at least mine, because I have to do less preparation.
And I get to watch a movie with my buddy Mike.
Woo! The film we will be watching is The Nightmare Before Christmas, directed by Henry Selick. Tim Burton's The Nightmare Before Christmas.
Ooh. A movie that, Mike, I don't know if I've told you this. I've never seen it.
What? Trace!
Mike just got up and ran around the room. Yeah, I've never seen it.
You don't know Jack and Sally?
Well, I mean, I'm aware
of them.
They're
from a Blink-182 song.
I know they're in the Blink-182 song. I've just never seen it.
Whoa! What were you doing this around Christmas? Holy crap.
That was too scary.
Oh my god.
I was scared by it.
It's so good.
It's only 76 minutes long.
It's a short movie. It's pretty perfect, honestly.
Okay. Well,
it's a movie that I really do love with all my heart, despite the fan base it has.
I guess just more of like it has an embarrassing fan base, I guess.
But so does Rick and Morty, and I love that too.
I mean, I feel like to an extent every fan base is embarrassing, so you just gotta accept it.
Except for Directioners.
Okay.
They're cool.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I like them.
You can follow Cinema of the State on Instagram and Cinema of State on Twitter. I am Mike McCabe Sad on all those things, including the website Letterboxd, where I review movies.
I am Trey Sever on Twitter, Instagram, Letterboxd, the Austin Chronicle newspaper.
Other things.
Yeah.
Google him. If you find another Trace Severa, I'd love to see it happen.
I would love to meet him and then have lunch with him. And maybe we could hang out.
See, I'm not interested in meeting the other Mike McCabe's because I know one. He's my dad. Ayo!
I've already seen how much the other Mike McCabe's fucking blow.
That's true. And we'll miss you.
Bye. I got my head held over you. I guess I'm still home.